So we're going to discuss about the what's called the kinematics of the bike, which is really a fancy term for the position and the power output and how all those things work together so you can put it together in a workable format for yourself, for energy system training, or to prescribe it to other people. Because there are some things that are important to know. I'll move around on a number of those different topics, but really two main areas we want to discuss is the position on the bike and how that leads into power production. Now, don't think of power as the pure definitional term of it. We're trying to create work that leads to an improvement in that work over time, hence we're calling it power, and it's two P's. So it's a good reminder for you as to what's important for the kinematics. Power before position, and I'll talk about a little position on the bike and include it in with power. We have these ideas around what you should be doing for position on the bike and how to essentially take this and move it into some form of training that's valuable. We take models of cycling to be used as all the research and evidence for a long period of time, because I'm sure you can imagine in the 1800s there was, maybe I don't even know, I think there was, if I'm wrong let me know, in the 1800s there was bicycles, if not late 1800s there was bicycles, but there wasn't a lot of assault bikes, okay? It's not that probably someone hadn't thought about it, and not that early bikes probably didn't have some locomotor reaction to the upper body, but there was mainly bikes. So you can just think about that, not only for activity and leisure, but for sport, because I just know, just think about it, Tour de France has been going on for a really long period of time. So you can imagine there's a lot of information in there on things we can derive from the sport of cycling in regards to power production, okay? But a couple of the two biggest things that we have to, I guess, wrap our heads around is that we've only really had 2 decades of practice. It may seem like a lot, but we've only had 2 decades of practice of the assault bike and how it's going to lead into better prescriptions. But we want to recognize that the arm usage is the fundamental major differences in strategy beyond just using the bike as a model for improving power. Okay? Because you want to think about that. When you're on a bike and you want to move forward, you're really, all the power production is largely coming from your ability to keep your hands on the handlebars and to just hold yourself stable while your legs do all the work. So I know this sounds so simple, but just think of the context now when you get on top of a bike or an assault bike and you're sitting and your legs are producing force, you also get to use your hands to help you in that force production. So although overall measurable wise, it's probably the same, it gets kind of complicated to understand the same power output, but overall the same power output's probably the exact same in both individuals. The chances of someone fatiguing for local muscle fatigue on a bike is much higher, right? Just think about that. Simply because that's all you're using, right? So you can't get tired on a bike and then be like, well, let's go arms. they can't be used along with your core, which connects your arms to your legs. They can't be used, if that makes sense, right? So, and I know all the elite cyclists will say, well, we're going up hills and we pull on, I get it. But you really can't use this locomotion of your arms to help you on that. So that allows you to understand, like, how do we get into these areas of power production and use this thing effectively based upon with what we got to work with. Secondly, the really important thing to consider that we've pulled from cycling models, as well as the talk about limitations of work and why you feel this way on the assault bike relative to other things like running and rowing and swimming and et cetera, is that you want your brain to go there and say, what is the assault bike and how is it different in power production and energy as opposed to any other modality? And that little conversation we want to spend a couple of minutes on here discussing, and that main differential there is that this creates largely concentric only activities to propel ourselves forward. Okay? I'll go off on a little tangent of the primal patterns and then come back in hopefully on that point, but we have been set up to go across land by walking. It's just the way we're put together. So just think of it. We can walk for, well, you may not be able to today or a large percentage of people can't do it, but we're set up to walk for hours and hours, right? We're not set up to ride a bike for hours and hours. So just think about that. That's one crisscross incorrect patterning that we're not set up to do. Now, it doesn't mean that, you know, I'll just, the simple answer, whatever you think we've been around for, bikes haven't been around as long as we've been walking. So that's the facts period ending in terms of that. But it's an important thing to consider because you have to recognize there's also some positives in the fatigue associated with what's called concentric activities and biking relative to walking or running. Because the running strategy or walking strategy is locomotion, and some other activities, especially running, those are two cardiorespiratory activities, right? When you do the running aspect, you have what's called some deceleration or eccentric activities in the work that's being done. Meaning, like, every time my foot hits the ground, I have to do this little eccentric contraction to keep myself from falling to the ground, obviously, if I can make it sound, you know, super important that every time you hit the ground is important. But when you're running, you'll probably recognize that there's a little bit more force going on, a little bit more activity in terms of those muscles decelerating you, right? Now, the problem with that, it requires a huge amount of energy, right? It requires a huge amount of energy, not only to land and accept the force, but to put energy back into creating force again to move us forward. Hence, the reason why this would be such a powerful alternative and why the assault bike is so good for its actual power production, it is largely only concentric actions, okay? So just think hard about that. I only have to push as a force, whether through my arms and pushing and pulling, and even the pulling action is concentric. I only have to push and pull with my arms or push with my legs, right? It's all concentric only activity. Now, there are some definite, you know, downsides to that. Back to the point I talked about of elite cycling or just being really good at cycling, you get a lot of local muscle fatigue. But now we got the upper body to be used with it so that when you get on there, you can see that the upper body usage along with the legs and the core, plus this idea that it's largely power only, and I'm using the terms power in terms of that concentric only activity, you can see the real good benefits of that for when we're gonna get into understanding, you know, limitings of fatigue, okay? So I did a good job of that, and I do want to now move from power and the conversation around that and tie it in a little bit when we get into position. Before I do that though, I want you to still really think hard around what the power over time curve, right, looks like, meaning what does power look like on a specific modality when you start, and then what does it look like after 5 minutes, and what does it look like after 35 to 60 minutes? I want you to think really hard, and I want you to put all different kinds of modalities in that curve. So we'll quickly go there. Skiing, right? So if you're just a person who wants to doing skiing, think about the contraction type. You know, I'm sorry, I should say skier. Contraction type. I've got to do very fast, you know, powerful flexion actions, right? Still all concentric actions, right? But just think about what the curve looks like after I do that for 60 minutes, right? I'm sure all the people who've used a skier go through and be like, oh my gosh, yeah, I don't even know if I could ever get to 60 minutes. But even that commentary itself, think about that. What's the strategy for doing the assault bike for 60 minutes? You just get on and move for 60 minutes, right? But it makes you think really hard around what is running like on that curve. What is rowing like on that curve? What's a Versa climber like on that curve, right? Just think about all the things we can put in place and recognize that each modality has its own power time curve. This is all, I did tie it in really well. This is all related to the actions and the contractions that are going on per rep. Right? If we know that these are largely concentric only contractions, right, and I'm not going to get local muscle fatigue only, you can see how this differs than another specific piece of machinery and modality. Okay? The main things you have to consider for position, I won't spend a lot of time on that because it's going to come with your assault bike manual as well as some practice of it is going to be beneficial for you, is that in the seat arrangement, it's going to be moving forward and backward. You want that seat to be in a position only based upon where it is in its saddle, such that when your arms are together at the top, and I'll show you what that looks like. When your arms are parallel at the top, would this be parallel? Yeah, parallel to one another. I want my body straight up and down or slightly forward. Now, this doesn't mean that based upon human anthropometrics and the size of everyone out there, obviously humans have a massive continuum of their size, but the bike only has a certain continuum you're gonna fit into, right? So we have to be, with that saddle position, straight up and down or slightly bent forward when my hands are parallel on the bars, okay? First thing you have to consider. Second thing you have to consider is that if I want to put out power effectively from my legs through my core and my arms, I want the variable of mechanics in my skeleton to remain as stable as possible. So the one area that has a capability of getting really unstable, which will start spitting off forces everywhere, is our pelvis and spine. So the second area that's very important for you to consider for setup besides the seat and the saddle, which is actually the only other thing you can change on this, right? Like I can't make the arms shorter, right? I can't move this portion of the bike this way. You make sense of that, right? There's only two things you can change, seat up and down or the seat saddle back and forth. The second area is that this pedal, when it's at the bottom and I'm on the seat, when I put my, this is actually a little too tall for me actually, I must have adjusted this right before. I'll try to explain it to you. When my heel is on the pedal at the bottom and I'm sitting on the seat, my pelvis should be stable. So I'm gonna have a slight bend in this knee when my heel is at the bottom pedal. Okay, so a slight bend. So really, it should look like this, folks, okay? Not like that, it should look like that, okay? Now, what that's gonna do if my heel is on the pedal, I have a slight bend in my knee, right now, my pelvis is like this, right? Just think, right leg, left leg, my pelvis is stable. So if this guy is like this, right? See if I, of course this is incorrect, but see if I was like this, now my pelvis is like that. But that's what's gonna happen when I start doing reps and reps of this. If I don't have that great foot position, my pelvis is gonna be doing this the whole time. And what did I say is the variability that we have to control because nothing else can move? It's the pelvis and the spine. So the pelvis needs to remain as stable as possible. So a cue for you to think, besides, you know, knowing where you are upright here, and fatigue will change up your positioning up here, you have to think about, I gotta keep my pelvis as stable as possible. It doesn't mean when you get tired that you won't be like, you know, doing a little this and like a little back and forth, but when you set up, you can't have this rotation between the pelvis and the spine the whole time, right? That makes sense? Okay, so for the setup of it, two main areas, the saddle, forward and back based upon your spine stripping down, and the pedal, that bottom leg, I'll be super clear with it here because my seat didn't allow you to see that. That bottom leg, when your heel is on the pedal, you should have just slight bend in the knee and the pelvis needs to be stable. Okay. Now that I've just touched the seat, there actually is a third area that you can play with. It's not a major variability, but you have to create a good stable position in this seat because this can tilt forward or backward. And I would suggest just making it as flat as possible, right? You see this one actually, the front part of the seat is a little lowered. And that will just create, you know, a change in where your sits bones are when you sit on the bike, because as you sit there for a period of time, the bones in your pelvis are pushing down right here. Right? And you don't want this guy impeding being up too high or down too low because you're gonna slip forward, rotate your pelvis, right? You'll be rotated this way if you think about that, right? If this is down, my pelvis will be rotated too forward, right? And just think of that seat as way back this way, my pelvis will be rotated back and then I can't turn over, okay? On position, but a little bit more around the kinematics of it, and this is the beauty of like how you create force and what you should be thinking about for design of things, because then you start saying, oh, if these muscles are fatigued, then I can probably mix this movement with this exercise. And as an example, right, like I'm not using my, I don't know, what would be a good example here. I'm not using my biceps that much in this, okay? Just as an example for people who sometimes get tired because of incorrect mechanics on the row erg. I'm not using my biceps that much. So is it possible that I could do this and get off and do some upper body pulling activities? Yeah, great idea. Does that make sense? Otherwise, example of that, and this is the reason why we need to know the mechanics, do you think I could get off after this doing a really, really hard for 2 minutes and do a whole lot of stuff for my quads? If you don't understand me asking that question, then you'll see if you do it, the downside of combining that and not knowing exactly the mechanical makeup here. If you do know the answer to that question, you'll kind of giggle because it's almost impossible to do work that's really super hard for this, which we call pain, for 2 minutes, and then get off and do anything with your legs. So, but that's an important consideration on the setup and the position of it because you need to know the dose effect and what muscles are being used in here, okay? Lastly, just so you know in terms of force production, remember as I'm trying to basically move this forward, a couple things here. I don't recommend playing with going backwards. That's just stupid. And I also don't recommend doing arms only. That's like secondary stupid. For multiple different reasons I don't want to get into, but just don't do it. Use the machine the way it's supposed to be used. That means forward momentum of your legs and using your arms and legs at the same time. Now, when you do that, just think about this. When I'm pushing down on this leg right now, this other arm has the capability of pushing with it. Remember my conversation on cycling and the addition that the assault bike adds to that? I hope you remember that. So this is the beautiful position that certainly adds to adding in power production. I'll reverse now. I'll come back. And we're going to go start again. I'm pushing down on this leg. I'm pushing with this arm. We're forgetting I have another hand. So I'm not only pushing on that arm, I'm pulling with this arm. So just think about that. I'm driving down on this leg. This leg's not being used that much. Remember, that's just on the pedal right now. I'm pushing down with this leg, creating force. At the same time, I'm pushing with my opposite arm and pulling with the same side arm, right? So just think about that action and just watch as I'm slowly doing it. Pulling this guy, pushing with that guy. See the slight little transition area? These are still concentric actions. Pelvis is stable, I'm in a great position, right? I'm doing my work. Now this guy is pushing down as I'm driving this guy forward and I'm pulling this guy back. I know you're like, James, you know, the bike can't move any other way, so just get on with it. It's very important to consider this because so many people get on, they think they should only be pushing with their arms or they should only be pulling with their arms, right? You have to recognize you want to increase power production. You have to know the mechanics, what muscles are being fatigued, why it's not only lower body itself, and you want to make the best usage of this so that you can actually express energy system training correctly when we do it, okay? So just to recap, saddle goes back and forth, seat goes up and down, make sure you're there so you don't spit off energy. It's a concentric only activity, which is not only coming from the lower body, you get to use your arms as well. And because of this only concentric powerful activity, you can combine it with a bunch of other things, as well as you'll recognize where this sits on the power time curve in relation to all other modalities.